Welcome to Durban. Today's going to be slightly different because I made the mistake this morning of, for the first time, actually reading my presentation, which is not something that always happens, but I lost interest by slide three. still a few surprises in store. So what we want to talk about today is the growth of the internet exchange and what we're seeing in the market and what we think people should be looking out for as well. So, I mean, most of you know who NAB Africa is. There's obviously some stats about who we are and what we do. One of the most difficult things about this is that this is a moving target and changes every day. It's difficult to keep up. And we'll just give an indication here. You can see that the amount of growth that we've seen just in 1 year. So you can see that the increase in the number of ports, the increase in the connected capacity. And we're now at a month and a little bit later after the July stats, and we're already up to about 2.7 terabits of connected capacity. 580 odd ports and 285 connected ASNs. So, I mean, as I said, this is something that changes all the time. And obviously, as you might expect, that comes with a couple of operational challenges. So we got to a point where obviously we needed to start thinking about the future. We started having more running into a couple of limitations on the platform that we did have. And we always talk about, I think everybody knows that we started out with a Juniper platform. And it was great at the time. You know, I think we just got to the point where we might have pushed it beyond what it was expected to do. And, you know, just to give you an indication, we started with one switch in each region, and we had 1 gigabit ports, and we thought that everything was good, and it was for a while. You know, at the time, I think 1 gigabit was the in thing, and people were happy to get a 1 gigabit port as opposed to taking a 10 meg port or something to that effect. So everything was good, and then along came Google, and you know, they don't operate at a gigabit, so we immediately had to go and buy these ridiculously expensive SFPs to run at 10 gig and upload modules and all sorts of things. So there was obviously a heavy cost in that. And I think at around the same time, we were at a peering conference, I think possibly in London, and at the same time, links, or I'm going to say PQs because I'm not this here, but they were talking about putting in 100 gig ports, and I was sitting in the audience and I was doing emails because, I mean, you know, we just got to 10 gig and I thought this is never going to happen to us. And it was at the same meeting that somebody else came to me and said, well, and we said that we had just put in our first 10 gig port, and you know, we were super chuffed with ourselves. And this guy said to me, well, just make sure that you've got enough stock because it's going to snowball from it. And literally it does. One 10 gig port leads to multiple other 10 gig ports, and it just turns into a continuous rolling snowball. So yeah, density was one of the things that we needed to concentrate on as well. We always brag about the fact that you could fit an entire internet exchange into a couple of in one rack, and that's just not the case anymore. I think in Johannesburg we've sort of had to expand out into about 4 racks. You know, this is just cabling. If you consider that we've got around 500 cables in Johannesburg connecting to the exchange, it becomes quite a big operation. So density was one of the most important things. We are still one of the ISPs that don't charge for ports, so we need to keep our staff counts reasonably low, so automation was a big thing for us. technical side, so we can't be sitting there playing around with the CLI every day, all day long. And so automation was important, and lastly we also needed a good reference site. So, we sent out RFIs to all of the vendors. Long story short, we eventually went with Arista, as you all know. And it was because when we sent out the RFI, one of the most important things that we wanted was 100 gig capability, and we needed it to be dense. And we just did not find it with any of the other providers, unless you were willing to pay a significant amount of money. So in terms of density, Arista came in, they had the great automation. And as I said, we had a trusted reference site in London that helped us make that decision. And also from a costing perspective, it beat out the others quite significantly. But I don't know how I'm going to get that commission for that afterwards. So then the actual migration experience. Again, as I said, the Juniper was fine. For the beginning of the exchange. One of the issues that we had, and we've spoken a lot about this, is the virtual chassis backplane. And I'm going to say this up front, if any of you ever get sold a virtual chassis, run away as fast as you can, because it just does not work. It cannot scale to the kind of numbers that you need. So, you know, we got to a point where the entire backplane, because of one of the limitations on one of the devices, the entire backplane was limited to around 32 gigabit per second, even though it was marketed as a 128 gig module. So there was some funny maths going on over there. And we got to the point where we eventually had to start using front panel ports to increase the capacity on the backplane. So literally at this stage, on that Juniper platform, the majority of the ports are just interconnects and virtual chassis backbone, with probably about only 20% of those actual ports being used for members. So it's a bit of a ridiculous situation. The other problem, of course, is that there's a limitation of 8 interfaces per bundle. The devices can't do ECMP or anything intelligent like that, so we only had 80 gigabit worth of traffic to play with when we were doing the migration. So it turned into initially a bit of a hit and miss. You know, if you move the wrong port at the wrong time, you're going to cause, you know, severe congestion between the two platforms. And given that we only had 80 gig, we tried very hard to keep it under 90% utilization. I think at one stage, because of a few new peers that joined, we peaked out, I think, at about 98% between the two platforms. So that was a very interesting night. We eventually had to get our ESPO stats in there to try and figure out which were the correct networks to move at the correct time, which came with its own problems because the CPUs on the whole platform couldn't handle exporting that much data. We learned a lot from it. It was not a lot of fun, but we are almost there. The problem now, of course, is that we started out when we bought the Arista's. We started out, I think, with 96 10 gig ports and I think 20 100 gig ports. And we figured that would last us for quite a while. And a few months later, we doubled up that capacity. And at the moment, we are, this is a big secret, but we're actually out of ports. So, we have an order arriving next week, hopefully. But just in terms of density, you know, so what we've got coming in next week, and it should be live by next week, is in 1U, 96 10 gig ports and 12 100 gig ports. And if you look at the numbers, we're adding an additional, I think it's about 380 odd 10 gig ports and 120 100 gig ports. And that should all be live by the end of next week, if we can get out of Durban. And, yeah, so what we learned. OneAgregate is a thing now. It is a thing in Africa. If you have a look at all of the big cloud providers that are coming, OneAgregate is just not a thing anymore. And you know, just to give an example, a show of hands, who has 10 gig on their network? Yeah, you see, this is the thing. 10 gig is the new entry level. We're not doing we're not doing 1 gig anymore. We've gotten to the point now where in Johannesburg we actually the balance has shifted completely. We're doing more 10 gigs than 1 gig. It is simply the new entry level. 400 gig multi mode is extremely cheap, but it is a pain. It is a real pain to do. Multimodal 100 gig, given the physical infrastructure requirements and the number of players that you need to run to do that personally. Take a message. And then, yeah, search up around various IPs, obviously, because I'm neutral, I'm going to point out everybody. You've got the guys from Flex Optics over there, the Apache guys over here, Lou from OSI is here as well. Speak to them. You know, most of these optics, I think, all come out of the same place anyway. It's just about the sticker that's put on them that changes the price. And yeah, also when you do get to 100 gig, make sure that you know what people are running. There's been quite a bit of confusion about which standards interoperate with each other. We've purchased a few duds which were labeled as one and were actually just a different flavor altogether. And also make sure you know what the members use, obviously. And that's it. Thank you very much. Oh, and I've been told to tell you all about this tonight. You're all expected to be there.
Thank you very much, Andrew. Just before you step up, does anybody have any questions for Andrew, quickly, before we go to the show?
Hi, Greg Medica. You obviously talk about provisioning 100 gig ports. What's the sort of maximum utilization you're currently seeing on those ports? Are people getting all the way to 90 gigs, or is it mostly just future-proofing for a little bit beyond 10 gig?
You know, one of the issues that we had at the search is that because we didn't have it previously, and because nobody seems to like 40 gig for anything, is port only. And you know, we have one member that has bundled ports all the way up to 80 gigabit per second. So now you can understand the problem with that is that you're using 8 ports on our infrastructure. I've had to run in 8 single mode fibers for you. At this stage we have provisioned some member facing 100 gig ports, but all of their equipment is stuck in customs. So it's for some reason it seems that in the last couple of months customs has gotten wind of something, and there is a ton of very expensive telecoms equipment sitting in customs. So it's difficult to say at this stage. On our backbone, we have provisioned multiple 100 gigs. So you know, we've changed to what you should refer to as the spike leaf topology, and we're running VXLAN over there. And we have multiple 100 gigs connecting all the leaves back to the spines. One of the issues we had initially, one of the confusions as well, was when we went to our cabling guys and said, we're running 100 gig, can you please put in the following brand of fiber? And that just is what they can't, because they're not 100 gig certified. However, this is part of the confusion, is when people start talking about 100 gig, they suddenly think that you have to have specialized cabling run in, and quite literally, I mean, there were people that gave us quotations, ridiculous quotations, on putting in specialized 100 gig certified infrastructure. But this is fiber. You know, we're doing single mode fiber. It's not the as long as you're running, obviously, it's not the it's not the fiber that turns the speaker across, it's the transceiver on the other side. So we are seeing, we do see close to 100 gigahertz running on the backbone, but it is ECMP across multiple links. So yeah, at this stage we haven't maxed out any of those ones. But as soon as customs relaxes a bit, I think we should see an interesting burst of traffic.
Michu Kimwangi, Internet Society. I'm curious about the costs between 100 gig ports and in terms from a member's point of view, where they're bundling 8 ports to get the 80 gigs vis-a-vis taking the 100 gigs. From both the IXP side and the members, what do the costs come to with respect to how much it costs you to buy the optics, the switch that actually the power port costs on 100 gig versus bundling the airport?
Yeah, so that, this has been always one of the confusing factors for us. And I still don't understand why 40 gig never became a thing, because it would save us a hell of a lot in terms of cost and in terms of money. But yes, if you compare a bundle of 8x10, it will be significantly cheaper than putting in a 1x100. That's just the reality. That's where we are just today. So prices are dropping all the time, but it is still cheaper to run that many 10 gigs and bundle them together. The difficulty is that from our point of view, we don't mind paying for the optics, even though it comes at quite a significant premium. It means that I have 7 less fibers running into my rack, That to me at this stage is one of the most important things. With that many cables going in or connecting to the exchange, it becomes a bit of a mission to manage the patch panels and to get more fibers in and infrastructure and that sort of thing. I mean, if you look at in Johannesburg, our original rack in Johannesburg, it is just cable. We've effectively locked down that track because we just can't put any more cables in there. So, yeah, look, the difference in cost is significant between the 100 and whatever, but it's just so much easier for us. Any more questions?
Thank you very much, Andrew. If you could please just give him a round of applause.
Just in time. Thank you so much, Andrew. It is time for tea. If everybody can just step outside for tea, please don't go too far. It's literally on your left-hand side as you step out. Enjoy your tea. Just a quick apologies for those that are viewing the session via our live stream. We had a bit of an issue with the lighting, but this will be fixed during the tea break. So thank you and see you in 30 minutes.
But it will be fixed, right?
Yeah.